Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video I want to discuss one of my favorite endocrine topics, which is DKA, or diabetic ketoacidosis. So we're going to talk about the etiology, the patho, some of the most common signs and symptoms, and then some of those complications that you as the nurse need to watch out for. So let's just start. So DKA is diabetic ketoacidosis. The etiology of DKA. DKA is actually a complication of type 1 diabetes mellitus. When a type 1 diabetic gets stressed for any reason, that can throw them into DKA, which is what we're going to talk about. Now, DKA is primarily a complication of type 1 diabetes. Our type 2 diabetic patients get something called hyperglycemic hyperosmolar syndrome, which is a different topic for a different video. But our type 1 diabetics get some sort of stress. 9 times out of 10, it is an illness. Of all the DKA patients that I've taken care of in my nearly 13-year career as a nurse, they come in and it started out as a stomach virus or the flu. Next thing they know, they're in DKA. And here's why. Any type of illness, any type of stress situation causes the stress response, all right? And this is where we're going to start the patho. And we know that with the stress response comes the release of stress hormones. Well, what are our stress hormones? Well, number one is cortisol, right? Cortisol is in direct opposition to insulin, so cortisol raises blood glucose. Also, epi and norepi are fight or flight hormones. They are also in opposition to insulin, so they also increase blood glucose. So that's what happens when we are under stress. Now, coming on down to the part where it says no insulin. Well, our type 1 diabetics, we know that type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disorder where the beta cells just do not produce adequate insulin, all right? So when you throw someone that is not producing adequate insulin into a state of stress and all these stress hormones get released that increase blood sugar, well, the fact that they have no insulin to protect them from that, that's going to lead to tremendous increases in blood sugar, all right? So one of the most obvious signs and symptoms, and I always try to tell my students this, don't overlook the obvious. Like when you're making out your care plans or whatever it is that you have to do, concept maps, don't forget to include those obvious signs and symptoms. The number one sign or symptom of DKA is going to be hyperglycemia, okay? Really high blood sugar. What you're also going to see as a result of this insulin deficiency, because this is an insulin deficiency in our type 1 diabetics, is lipolysis. Now, lipolysis occurs because there is no insulin to protect their bodies from lipolysis. Normally, that is one of insulin's jobs. It protects our body from breaking down fat to be used for energy, because the byproduct of lipolysis are fatty acids, which are then converted to keto acids, and that throws the body into a state of metabolic acidosis. So as a result of no insulin, the body is not protected from lipolysis or the breakdown of fats like it should be. So not only do we see high blood sugar, we're going to see the patient in a state of metabolic acidosis because the body is having to break down fat to be used for energy. Those fatty acids are converted into keto acids, which throws the body into a state of metabolic acidosis. Okay, so we've got the high blood sugar, we've got the metabolic acidosis that goes along with it. Also, with high blood sugar, always remember your three P's: polydipsia, polyuria and polyphagia, right? So anytime you see a high blood sugar, you're going to see the three P's. So let's talk about those individually. So polydipsia, that is extreme thirst. That's going to occur in DKA patients for several reasons, but mainly because their serum osmolality is going to be very, very high, all right? Their blood is going to be very concentrated because of this tremendous increase in blood glucose. So the body says, hey, we need something to dilute this out. We've got too much blood glucose. Our serum osmolality is way too high. So the patient gets very, very thirsty, and that's where the polydipsia comes into play. Polyuria. Polyuria is where there is frequent urination. Now we call this an osmotic diuresis. All right, so what happens when the patient starts urinating, blood sugar is spilling out, glucose is spilling out into the urine, and we know that glucose has pulling power. Glucose has osmolality, osmotic pulling power. So where glucose goes, urine flows also. So as the patient begins urinating and losing glucose out into the urine, more and more and more and more urine is going to follow. So that is going to be a huge factor with DKA because the blood sugar is going to be so high. So we've talked about polydipsia, we've talked about polyuria. Now polyphagia. Polyphagia is where the patient is very, very hungry. And the reason for this is that without insulin, there is no way to feed your cells because insulin, you know, has a lot of jobs. The main job of insulin is that it acts as a key to unlock the cells of adipose tissue, muscle tissue, the liver, and it allows glucose to flow into those cells. But without insulin to do that, without insulin to act as a key to open the gate to allow glucose to flow in, those cells go into a state of starvation. So the patient feels very, very hungry. All right, so that is the three P's that you're gonna see with hyperglycemia. We talked about why you're going to see metabolic acidosis with the breakdown of fats that turn into fatty acids, which turn into keto acids. And with any state of acidosis, you are going to see a hyperkalemia, all right? So we actually really, really want these patients to come in hyperkalemic because what are we going to do to them when they get there to the hospital? We're going to start IV insulin. And what does insulin do to potassium? It drops it. So we want these patients to come in hyperkalemic, which they should, because acidosis and hyperkalemia or elevated potassium go hand in hand, just like alkalosis and hypokalemia go hand in hand. Also with the metabolic acidosis, you are going to have the patient complaining of stomach pain and nausea. They're going to be throwing up, and that all kind of goes along with the acidosis. That's kind of one of the ways the body tries to rid itself of extra acid, is by causing the vomiting response. So you'll have the patient complaining of stomach pain or reporting stomach pain, having some nausea and vomiting because of the metabolic acidosis. All right, so the biggest complication, the worst thing that could happen to a DKA patient is for them to become hypokalemic. Hypokalemia is what kills the vast majority of our DKA patients, and for many, many reasons. Mainly because of what we're doing when we treat them, we're giving them insulin, right, which drops blood glucose. So that's why you're going to see like certain protocols for DKA patients that, of course, we're going to hydrate them first with normal saline. Then when they are stabilized, their blood pressure is okay, they're not in any kind of state of shock, we're going to give them hypotonic solution to kind of bring that serum osmolality on down. Eventually, they're going to have some D5W because we don't want to drop their blood glucose too rapidly, because rapid drops in serum osmolality can be very dangerous. But we're also going to add a little potassium to those IV fluids as well, because we do not want these patients to become hypokalemic, all right? So the number one biggest killer, biggest threat to our DKA patients is hypokalemia. And if you take anything away from this video today, I want you to remember that. I want you to remember that we want our DKA patients to come in hyperkalemic. We want that potassium to be high when they come in, because what we're about to do to them to help the acidosis, to help the DKA, is going to drastically drop the potassium. Also, they've probably had some kind of stomach bug, you know, for quite some time. And we know that when we vomit a lot, prolonged severe vomiting also leads to hypokalemia. So always watch your potassium on your DKA patients. All right, so that sort of kind of wraps up the etiology, the brief patho of DKA, the signs and symptoms that you're going to expect, the signs and symptoms that you need to watch out for, and the biggest potential complications. And I really hope that you got something out of this video today. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button if you have not. If you like what you see, head over to thedoctornurse.com. Subscribe to our mailing list there. There's already a couple of Pathopedia ebooks up on the website I'm really excited about. CV and respiratory are already up there and ready for purchase. So I just thank you so much for watching. Hope you got something out of it. And I hope to hear from you guys real soon.